Hello, I welcome you all to EdChem channel. In this video lecture, we are going to discuss about the next part of atomic structure. First part, we'll discuss about the waves. What are waves? We'll detailly discuss about these waves. Next part, we are going to discuss about the Planck's quantum theory, the basic fundamental concept of this quantum. Next, we'll discuss about the Bohr's atomic model, which gives the idea how the structure of atom and what are the components present in the atom. So you can see this is the Bohr's model, where this one is the shell, electrons, neutrons and protons. We'll detailly discuss about where the exactly the electrons are present, what are this orbit, shell and all the details. Okay, so without a doubt, let's start. Waves. As we have already discussed in the earlier slides, what are electrons, protons and neutrons. Okay, now we'll discuss about few concepts like waves. So what are waves? Waves means transfer of energy from one point to another point without any actual transportation of matter between points. So see, what is the meaning? See, we know that there are various forms of energy. So light energy, sound energy. So this energy, they transfer from one point to another point. So without transferring of matter, matter do not transfer. What it transfer? The energy. So the energy transfer from one point to another point without any transfer of matter. You see that there is two points. Here is the waves. So wave, they propagate, and there are few terms. We'll call it as a crest. Crest means the upper part. Trough is the lower part. So there is the upper and lower part, and this part is continuously moving from one point to another point. Okay. So there is a transfer of energy. Now, what are the components in the wave? First is the wavelength. So what is the wavelength? You see, the distance between two adjacent crest or trough of the wave. You see, so this is the distance. So from crest and trough, what is the distance? How can you measure? We can measure. See, this is point one, here one crest, here one trough. So the distance between crest and trough, so what is the wavelength? So this is the wavelength, you see, from point A to point B. So what is the wavelength here? The wavelength is from this point to this point. So this is one wavelength. You can consider one trough and one crest also. So how can you consider? From here you see one trough, another is the crest. So what is the wavelength from this point to this point? This is the wavelength. We'll call it as a lambda. Okay. So this is the symbol of wavelength. Next, coming to the time period. What is the meaning of time period? Time for one complete oscillation of the wave. That means the time took for the wave to oscillate one crest and one trough. So this complete one crest and one trough, the time taken to complete this path is known as time period. Okay. Next one is the frequency. Frequency is the number of oscillation per unit time. As frequency is number of oscillation per unit time. So that means per unit time or per second, the number of oscillations is per unit time, the number of oscillation the wave will take. Okay. So this is the per unit time, the number of oscillations. Next one is wave number. What is the meaning of wave number? 1 by lambda is called wave number. Okay. Next one is the amplitude. Amplitude is the highest of the crest or depth of a trough of a wave. You see, what is the meaning amplitude? You see this from point A, this is the height of crest, right? Or this is the height of trough. So this is known as amplitude or A. This is also amplitude or A. So this is the maximum height. Okay. So the highest crest or highest trough is known as amplitude. So this is one amplitude, this is another amplitude and another amplitude. Now there is a relation between frequency and wavelength. So the relation is frequency is equal to C by lambda. So what is C? Velocity of light. And value of C is 3 into 10 to the power 8 meter per second. And you have to remember, and frequency and wavelength, if C is constant, then we can say that frequency and wavelength, they are inversely proportional to each other. So this is a very important point to remember this formula. Okay. So next we'll discuss about the electromagnetic wave. As the name suggests, that's electromagnetic. That means the wave where electric and magnetic field are there. So the wave consisting oscillating electric and magnetic field. You see this picture here. So this is one axis, y-axis. This is another z-axis. Okay. So what happens in the z-axis, there is electric field, whereas in the y-axis, there is magnetic field. So whenever the wave propagate, so that wave propagate in a such direction that there will be two fields. One is the electric field. This is the electric field. Another is the magnetic field. And those wave, they propagate perpendicularly. You can see that the angle between y and z will be obviously 90. So whenever they propagate perpendicularly. Okay. So these are known as electromagnetic waves. And I guess already you know what is time period, amplitude, frequency, velocity. Okay. So next, coming to the electromagnetic spectrum. This is very important. Many exams ask about this spectrum. So as we already discussed about frequency and wavelength, they are inversely proportional to each other, right? So as you see that certain electromagnetic spectrums are given. So those spectrums are cosmic rays, gamma rays, X-rays, ultraviolet rays, vacuum. This is ultraviolet, visible, IR, far and near. You can consider these are IRs, microwaves and radio waves. So as we go from left to right, you see that from left to right, wavelength is increasing. So that means radio waves has more wavelength than the cosmic rays. So as we already know that radio waves, we are listening FM radios or some radio mirchi. So those all are radio waves. We are using microwaves in our home. Okay. IR waves, visible rays. This here comes the year. V-I-B-G-Y-O-R. V-I-B-G-Y-O-R. Okay. So you just remember this waves. Now from left to right, lambda is increasing. Whereas from left to right, your frequency is decreasing. Why? Because those are inversely proportional to each other. Okay. I guess this concept is clear to you. And just remember the sequence. It will be very helpful. This is the lambda values given. Okay. For all these waves. So next we are going to discuss about quantum theory. So let us just understand what is the meaning of quantum theory. So Planck's quantum theory. Planck is the name of the scientist. He gave the theory. The statement says that atoms or molecules could emit or absorb energy only in discrete quantities, small packets, and not in the arbitrary amount. So to understand this concept, let us just take one example. Let's suppose one source is there. From this source, the energy is transmitting, okay, to a person. So now the point is, if this person is absorbing the energy and this source is emitting the energy, so the Planck says that whenever the energy transmits from one source to one endpoint, the energy transmitted from point 1 to point B, those energies transmitted they in the form of small packets. That means the energy which is transferring from the source to a point P, that energy is transmitting in the form of small packets. So let us think these are the small packets, okay? So as we know that waves are energy, so this transmission of this wave is nothing but the transmission of the energy, and those energy they transmit from S to P in the form of small packets. Okay, so these packets are known as quantum. Okay, so he says that whenever the transmission of energy occurs, there is the transmission of energy. So I think this quantum is clear to you. So quantum is nothing but the transmission of energy in the form of small packets. Okay. Now Planck gave the name quantum to the smallest quantity. That means he gave this energy or this energy packet as the quantum. Now he again said that the energy of this quantum, that means the energy of this packet, I'm taking one energy packet. So this is our quantum. So the energy of this small packet is directly proportional to the frequency of the wave by which it is transmitting. Okay. So the energy is directly proportional to the frequency. Now what is H? H is a constant. So H is known as Planck's constant. Planck's constant. Okay. So H, value of H is 6.626 into 10 to the power minus 34 joule second. You remember. Okay. So E is equal to H nu. Next is, a body can emit or absorb energy only in terms of integral multiple of the quantum number. That means the energy which is transmitting from this point to this point, those energies are integral multiple quantum numbers. That means that value of n is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. Okay. So there won't be any half or any fraction or any minus. So that energy transmitted, those are in the form of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. If you put 1, you will get the 1 energy of the photon, 2 energy photon, and 3 energy photons, like that. Okay. So next we'll discuss about Bohr's atomic model. Bohr's atomic model. Discuss about the postulates. First postulates, the atom has a central massive core nucleus where all the protons, neutrons are present. The size of the nucleus is very small. Bohr said that in an atom, there is a core present. So inside that core, all the protons and neutrons are present. Okay. Second point, the electron in an atom revolve around the nucleus in orbit. The orbits are known as stationary state. So around the nucleus, different orbits are present. So from in this orbit, the electrons are revolving. Okay, in this orbit, the electrons are revolving. And this orbit are stationary state. That means these orbits are not moving, not changing their energy. So they are fixed. Next point, the angular momentum. Angular momentum is equal to nh by 2 pi. So angular momentum is mvr. What is m? Mass, v, velocity, r is the radius. Is equal to nh by 2 pi. N can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and so on. And h is Planck's constant. Pi is already you know. So somehow he calculated the angular momentum is nh by 2 pi. So angular momentum means, you see, whenever any body revolve around a circular path, that body will have one certain angular momentum. So as these electrons are revolving around the fixed path, so this electron or the electron which is present on the shell will have a particular angular momentum, and that is given by nh by 2 pi. So next one is, the emission or absorption of radiation by the atom takes place where the electron jumps from one stationary to another stationary. See what is the meaning. Whenever the electrons are present, jumps from one orbit to another orbit. Okay. So what will happen? So the electron absorb the energy. The meaning is, whenever it is in the lower state and it is jumped to the higher state, so the electron absorbs the energy. You see, absorb. Okay, so the electron absorbs the energy when it goes from lower to higher. In the end, when the electron jumps from higher to lower orbit, the amount of energy is going to release. Okay, so this is the release amount, where in this case, the amount of energy is going to absorb. Lower energy state is called ground state. So that means this first energy state is called ground state. Okay. So next one, the radiation is emitted or absorbed as a single photon whose energy is equal to the difference in energy of two electron in the two orbit involved. See what is the meaning. Whenever there is a transmission or absorption of energy, okay, so the energy is transmission or absorption, that is due to the difference in energy. So the meaning is, whenever there is absorption or emission from two energy state, we have to take the difference, energy difference, and that difference of energy is given by delta is equal to h nu. So next one is, Bohr theory explain the spectral lines of one electron. So example, this one is He, okay. So He plus Li2 plus. So Li2 plus has one electron, He plus is also one electron system. Okay. Bohr also told about the different types of shell. Types of shells are, first shell is known as K shell. This is the K shell. Second shell is known as L. Third shell is known as M. Fourth shell is known as N, and so on. Okay, so these shells are represented with the value. So that is known as N. If N is 1, that is K shell. If N is 2, that is L shell. If N is 3, that is M shell, and so on. Okay, so you just remember N represent your shell number, K, L, M, N, and so on. Next, let us discuss about the calculation of radius of Bohr. So Bohr radius, so R is known as Bohr radius, and Bohr radius is given by 0.529 into N square by Z. What is this N? N is the shell number and Z is the atomic number. Okay, what is A naught? This is A naught is the angstrom. Angstrom is the unit. So you just remember the formula. Next one, velocity. So how we are calculating this factor? You see, whenever there is a nucleus and one electron is revolving around the nucleus, okay, so obviously there will be one radius, right? As this electron is revolving around the nucleus, it must have some velocity. So the velocity is given by V is equal to 2.188 into 10 to the power 6 Z by N meter per second. Again, this fact, what is Z? Atomic number. N is the shell number. So if we asking about the what is the velocity in the first cell or second cell or third cell, you can easily put the values and you will get the answer. Okay, so next one is the energy. See, energy means as this electron is revolving, so that means it must have some energy, and that energy is nothing but total energy. So total energy is equal to, as it is revolving, that means it must have one kinetic energy and a potential energy. So total energy is equal to kinetic plus potential. So that energy expression is given by En is equal to 2 pi square z square e to the power 4th m is the mass of the electron, k square divided by n square by h square. So all these factors are known to you. What is k? K is a constant. So this is the expression. So you don't have to remember this expression. Rather, if you put all these values, you see what are the constant factor. H is a constant, K is a constant, M is constant, E is also constant, and these are constant. So if you put all these values, we'll get minus 13.6 Z square by N square electron volt. So you have to remember this formula, okay, to solve the numerical. Again, if you'll convert that unit into joules, so that will be minus 21.8 into 10 to the power minus 19 Z square by N square, joule per atom. Okay. Again, if you'll convert it into calories, so minus 313.6 Z square by N square kilocalories per mole. Generally, the questions ask about on this formula. So you have to remember the formula. Okay. So minus 13.6 into Z square by N square electron volt. Now coming to this formula, sometime the question may ask you, if the total energy is this, what is the potential energy? So you have to remember, total energy is equal to potential energy by 2 is equal to minus kinetic energy. So what is this minus sign represent? Minus sign represent the attracting force between nucleus and the electron. Okay, I think these formulas are clear to you. Just remember. So now, using the formula, E is equal to minus 13.6 Z square by N square, we will calculate the energy in different orbit. So if this is the nucleus, okay, so the first energy level, that is known as K shell. Okay, so the K shell, for the K shell, N is equal to 1. This is also known as ground state. Okay. And above that, there is another energy state. So after K, there will be L. For L, N is equal to 2, right? And this is known as first excited state. Okay. Above that, there will be M. So for M, N is equal to 3. So this is known as second excited state. Okay. Above that, there will be another energy label, N. So for N is equal to 4. So this will be third excited state. Okay. So as we know, the formula of the energy is equal to minus 13.6 Z square by N square. Okay. So if you look, the first energy state, that is ground state, and the energy in the ground state, if you'll put N is equal to 1. So if you'll put N is equal to 1, what is the energy here? So here the energy is minus 13.6 Z square. So if this hole is a hydrogen atom, then you can think of this as 1. Okay. So next, what is the energy in the second? Second energy is equal to minus 3.41 Z square. How do you get 3.41? You just put, so E is equal to minus 13.6 Z square. What is the value of N here? N is equal to 2. So 2 square, you will get this answer. Okay. Next is the third one. So energy in the third one is equal to minus 1.51 Z square. Okay. So the energy here, it will be, how do you get the answer? 13.6 Z square by N square. Here N is 3. Okay. Now energy in the fourth one. So what is the energy in the fourth one? Fourth one energy is equal to minus 0.85 Z square. Okay. So you just remember. Next one is, what is the energy difference then? How do you get energy difference? So the energy difference between ground state and first excited state, how do you get? Final energy minus initial energy. I'm doing one. Let's suppose this is 1, 2, 3, and 4. Okay. So how do you get this energy difference? Higher energy, that is E2 minus E1. So what is E2 minus E1? Minus 3.41 minus of minus 13.6. So how much you will get? You will get 10.2. Okay. So 10.2 is the energy difference here. What is the energy difference here? What is the energy difference between E3 and E2? E3 and E2 is these values minus this value. So we will get the value is 1.89. And in the third difference, this difference is this value minus this value. So the energy difference is 0.66. Okay. I think this is clear to you. So next we'll discuss few questions. So question number one, calculate the radii of second Bohr orbit of Li 2+. So now, as we know that radius is given by 0.529 n square by z. So here, what is the value? N is equal to, what is n? Shell number. So that is n is equal to second shell. So n is equal to 2 here. What is z? Z means atomic number. So what is the atomic number of lithium? So don't consider this plus charge. Okay. So lithium atomic number is 3. Now putting the values, this is angstrom. So 0.529 n square. What is n? 2 square divided by 3 angstrom. Okay. So if we'll calculate this, the answer will be 0.705 angstrom. Okay. So next question is, calculate the energy of an electron in the first Bohr orbit of He+. So as we know that E is given by minus 13.6 Z square by N square. The unit is electron volt. So apart from this, there is another formula. So that is minus 21.8 into 10 to the power minus 19 Z square by N square. This is joule. Okay. So you can calculate both the factors. So that is minus 13.6. So what is the value of Z here? Helium. For helium, Z is equal to 2. Okay. So here 2 square divided by which orbit? First Bohr orbit. That means N is equal to 1. So this is 1. So if we'll calculate this, the answer is 54.4 electron volt. Okay. This is also same unit. So if we'll put the value minus 21.8 into 10 to the power minus 19, again What is z here? Z is 2 square divided by 1 square. So if we'll calculate this, the answer is minus 87.2 into 10 to the power minus 19 joule. Okay, so this is one answer in terms of joule. This is also another answer in terms of electron volt. Okay, thank you for watching this video. If you want to connect with me with my social media account, my Insta and Twitter handle is this. Like and subscribe this video and share with your friends. Till then, signing off.